Good morning, everyone. Would you like to stand, those who can, and join us in our first song, Love God, Love People.
This is the first day of the rest of your life. This is the first day of the rest of your life. 'Cause even in the dark, you can still see the light. It's gonna be alright. Gonna be alright. This is the first day of the rest of your life. This is the first day of the rest of your life. 'Cause even in the dark, you can still see the light. It's gonna be alright. Gonna be alright. And love will hold us together. Make us a shelter to weather the storm. And I'll be my brother's keeper, so the whole world will know that we're not alone.
Welcome. Welcome to Hancock United Methodist Church, a place of loving grace, of hope and perseverance. God invites all of us to be part of his beloved community. God invites us all to share the good news. If you're worshiping with us from home this morning, will you please let us know by dropping a comment or hitting one of the emoji buttons? And for those in the sanctuary, let us take a moment. Don't make me call you twice. Back to your seats. Please join me in the call to worship. Children of the living God.
God loves us with the love of a parent.
Children of the living God.
Despite our failings, God continues to save us.
Children of the living God.
We are here to worship God of love, justice, and grace.
Let us pray. God, our holy parent, there are moments when we feel as though we're separated from you, times where we have chosen our own agendas over you. As we gather to worship today, remind us that despite our wandering souls, you are still home to us. Thank you, nurturing God, for welcoming us into this space today. Amen.
So we are continuing our worship series, Profit Margins. And in this 9-week journey of discovery, our traveling companions have been several of the prophets. We've heard from Elisha and Amos, and today we hear from Hosea. And we're reminded that a prophet is a messenger of God, or one who speaks for God. And as we've heard and listened to the encounters of the prophets, as they've had dialogue with God, or they've had dialogue with a king, or they've had whatever the narrative is that we've heard with them in this series, we're finding that some of what we're hearing can cause us to have what I affectionately like to term the squirm factor, right? It makes us kind of squirm in our seats a little bit. It may make us uncomfortable. It may challenge us to step out of our comfort zones and the places where we would prefer to stay. But in all of this, I want us to also see the hope that is in the storylines that we're hearing. The hope and the amazing faithfulness of the God that we serve, the God that creates us and nurtures us and provides for us. So I invite you to listen as Linda reads scripture from 1 John, our New Testament reading, and also the words from Hosea today.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Our first reading is found in the New Testament in 1 John. Please turn in your Bibles to 1 John chapter 4, beginning with verse 7. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Savior of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, "I love God," and hate a brother or sister are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. This ends our reading from 1 John. Please stand and sing with us, "Great is thy faithfulness." It is number 140 in your hymnals, or the words are on the screen.
Thank you.
Testament in Hosea. Please turn in your Bibles to Hosea chapter 1, beginning with verse 2. When the Lord first spoke through Hosea, the Lord said to Hosea, "Go, take for yourself a wife of prostitution and have children of prostitution, for the land commits great prostitution by forsaking the Lord." So he went and took Gomer, daughter of Diblaim, and she conceived and bore him a son. And the Lord said to him, "Name him Jezreel, for in a little while I will punish the house of Jehu for the blood of Jezreel, and I will put an end to the kingdom of the house of Israel. On that day I will break the vow of Israel in the valley of Jezreel." She conceived again and bore a daughter. Then the Lord said to him, "Name her Lo-Ruhamah, for I will no longer have pity on the house of Israel or forgive them, but I will have pity on the house of Judah, and I will save them by the Lord their God. I will not save them by bow or by sword or by war or by horses or by horsemen." When she had weaned Lo-Ruhamah, she conceived and bore a son. Then the Lord said, "Name him Lo-Ami, for you are not my people, and I am not your God. Yet the number of the people of Israel shall be like the sand of the sea, which can neither be measured nor numbered. And in the place where it was said to them, 'You are not my people,' it should be said to them, 'Children of the living God.'" For the word of God in scriptures, the word of God among us, the word of God within us, thanks be to God. We now invite the children to come up for the children's message.
You guys get this from a kid's point of view. Okie dokies? All right. So I have for you this kind of questioning. I want to be able to ask you a couple things, okay? All right. First, could I have a high five this morning? You don't have to do it, but could I get a high five from anybody this morning? Could I do one? Oh, thank you. There's one. There's two. There's three. There's four. Five. You gonna hook me up? Oh, my love. Thank you. So you made a choice there, right? You didn't have to, but you did. All right. Mr. Bobby, would you like a piece of candy this morning? Would you? Mama's open. Okay, it's yours. All right, this is yours. My little friend's here. I'm going to let you, because he's just cute and tiny, but you guys are my big kids. I'm going to let you decide. And my bag is candy. Do you guys want a piece, or you don't have to have one? Okay, you can have these. Okay, here's my last thing I want to know. Okay, free choice, free will. I got a raw egg with me today. Could you hold this for me real quick? I'm going to try a little experiment. Would any of you enjoy this morning? No? Are you sure? You have the choice.
No.
No? Okay. Yeah, that's not the option, but thank you so much, my love. So, with each one of those questions came a choice, right? It was your free will. God doesn't give you the choice of whether or not to love. He says, you will love. You will love everyone. Okay, let's take that a step further. So, and she made sure she's using her notes just a little bit this morning. So here was my next one. If I asked you some fruits, you would know them if you were by their tree, right? That'd give you a clue that you were getting the right thing. So an apple, where's it gonna come from? You see the apple tree that's better beyond, right? Okay. I go looking through another path of area, and I find these. What should I see these coming from? An orange tree. Okay. Last one. Where am I going to find lemons? At the lemons. Okay. So Jesus tells us that to love for others will be the fruit that will show us that we are his. We are his disciples. We are his children. So just like that apple tree proves that there was an apple, or vice versa, apple shows there were apple trees, you have to just kind of go with the fact that you've got to love. You've got to love to show the love that God has for you. You've got to love to show that you have the love for others. Showing that love is being that love, just like that apple is coming from that tree. Now, I'm going to play one more tricky around with you guys, but this is more of a question. Who's here ever had a fight? Okay. Who here fights with their siblings?
Addy.
Really? Okay. I'll speak to that one. Mine all try to mommy, but they're a little old. That's their problem, not mine. But we don't always get along. Who's here had a problem at school? Who's heard mom or dad, no words, but we've heard moms and dads have problems. Maybe just even driving down the road, they just don't like the person on the highway in front of them or behind them. Thank you for pointing. You have an issue. In a moment's time, you have said hateful, hurtful, mean things. If you don't let yourself get forgiven for them, that is not showing God's love. I speak to my own too. Mom will pick on you guys. You only have each other at the end of the day, sometimes. In the future, mom and dad may go. Life will happen, death may come. You've had each other. If you have a really big fight where you don't allow for each other to forgive one another and remember that you're supposed to love one another, it's gonna be a horrible way to go. Sometimes it's much better to just go, okay, that's what it was. I'm really sorry, God. I was not doing what you needed me to do. I was not being the way you asked me to be. I like your forgiveness. I'm going to go forward in love. One of the hardest things, even as an adult, that we always have to remind ourselves, especially if we are trying to be the best Christian we can be, the best representative of God that we can be to others, is that we love everyone. And here's another flavor to it. It's not just about loving those that bothered you. Do you know one of the things I struggle most with? Is remembering to love those that have done others harm. They still deserve love. It's hard to handle because they've done a hurt to someone. They've broken a law. They've made a poor choice. But if I'm truly good and you are truly a good keeper of God's goal, God's love, you're going to do it. Now, here's my last little one, and it goes a little bit where I started with the brothers. It says, love all your brothers and sisters. Now, we can take that literal. I'd really love it if you, alien and right, loved each other. But really, these are all your brothers and sisters. Some of them may look a little younger, a little older. Some of them are going to think different than you. And when you go out further than our church family, you're going to see many different versions of brothers and sisters. At the end of the day, just got to love them. So here's what I want to know. None of you are really liars, right? You're the best truth tellers that you can be, correct? So here's what I'd like you to do. I'd like you to close your eyes. And I might get this a little bonker, but I'm going to make it through. And I want us to pray. I want us to ask for forgiveness. I want us to remember to ask for it daily. Because we mess up every day. That's human. That's making choice. It's that free will God provided us. But I want you to say, I'm going to love everyone. I'm going to love my brothers, my sisters. And I'm going to hope for that forgiveness, ask for it. And then when I'm done, last thing I'm going to do is I'm going to love. And that, my dears, is our quick lesson this morning. Sound pretty good? All right, you can open your eyes, get your piece of candy, and go back to your seats. My sisters are not up for debate right now. All right.
Yeah. I saw all the seahorses in my head.
There's a seahorse? Oh my. I don't think that's part of the lesson this morning.
That was.
So risky love. Gayla touched on it with the kids, right? Loving when it's hard. But in our scripture, we heard about a God of love. And Hosea, when we listen to that scripture, that can be a little confusing. Because it's like, what is God doing? What? And many times we think about, or I hear people say, well, the God of the Old Testament is the God of judgment, right? God of the law, you gotta follow the law. The God of the New Testament is the God of love. But that's really not an accurate, those aren't accurate statements. You see, because God is God in Old and New Testament. And God is love in both of those books, those sections with all of those books in each of them. And in Hosea, we see a God that calls for risky love. Hosea begins his ministry with an assignment. And in my mind, it was kind of a most unusual assignment in that God instructed him to get married. Now, that's not anything out of ordinary for a young man in that day and age. But what is out of the ordinary is that God instructs him to marry a woman whose profession is one that he probably would not have considered someone that he would marry. God wants Hosea to marry a prostitute. Now, we need to understand something about that. You see, in that society, in that time, there were many gods and many temples, right? And that's been a lot of what we've been hearing, where the people of Israel have strayed from God and they're worshiping these other gods. Well, part of worshiping these other gods was temple prostitution. So, what we're hearing, I'm going to make sure we get that linkage, right? Because what God is saying is to marry a woman who is worshiping other gods. Now, I don't know about you, but that kind of makes me scratch my head a little bit. And this directive comes on the heels of God being frustrated and fed up with the people of Israel and their rebellious ways. God was the God that delivered, rescued, and redeemed the people, yet they were still swayed by other gods, by idols, which compromised and placed their relationship with God in harm's way. God is angered and God is hurt to be abandoned by a people who had so quickly forgotten the one true God. How many of us fall back on anger when we're hurt? Is it easier to process anger than it is to process hurt? We have a God who is hurt and angry also. You see, God wants Hosea to know this despair. God wants Hosea to know the bitter sting of love that is unrequited, of betrayal. God wants Hosea to know the deep pain of what it's like to see those who once worshiped and praised and celebrated God, who now abandon God to worship false idols. So Hosea obeys God, and he marries a woman from a city whose name means two cakes, and her name is Gomer. Hosea doesn't resist this woman or even the idea of her. In fact, he marries her and they begin to have children. And it is here that God calls us to risky love. It's a love that responds lovingly, even when hurt, or even when our love is not returned. God prepares the prophet to receive certain heartbreak that equipped Hosea to serve in the prophetic engagement. You know, it's really hard to speak about something from a place that you don't know or that you haven't experienced. It's often those who have known poverty intimately, or those who have benefited from, and in some cases been saved by, being an immigrant. It's often those who perhaps lost their business to large corporations, or those who have been repeatedly called derogatory names, those who have been passed over for promotion because they were women, those who have been muted by strict voting laws. These are a few who bring the prophetic ministry, bring to the prophetic ministry a tender, personal, and deep passion because they have had the human experience of suffering and the desire to see the redemptive healing that God can bring. So how? How do we present that risky prophetic love without falling into cliches or falling into things that are at a surface level? Let me suggest that we do that by telling stories, right? You've heard me say, everybody has a story. Who can tell, who here today can tell of someone who never gave up on you, even though you made bad choices repeatedly? Who can describe caring for a loved one who no longer recognizes you and might even lash out at you? Who can relate a story of setting boundaries and sticking to them even while holding out hope for transformation? This one I might as well raise both hands. Many of you have heard me tell a little bit about my own story of my ex-husband, my children's father, who suffered and suffers from addiction. And having to set boundaries and having to stick to them while holding out hope for transformation. That was not an easy road to travel. There were times that you question yourself. There are times that you lament with all you have to God because you're crying out for someone to be transformed. All the while needing transformation ourselves. Better yet, who can tell of seeing someone who loves in these risky ways? Someone who has cared for a loved one who no longer recognizes them and lashes out with them. Someone who loves by setting boundaries and sticking to them. Someone who continues to love and never give up on those that are making less than good choices. Have you witnessed someone loving like that in your lives? Or can you talk about receiving, experiencing that kind of risky love? Can we do that? Can we share these stories? You see, the person who tells the story is important, right? One of the functions of us as a community of faith is being the body of Christ. We're to lift each other up. And just like many times people don't recognize their own gifts, they may not recognize that they're loving in this way. It's just what they do. Others may be able to see that better than we can see it ourselves. So who do you see that shows this kind of perseverance in love? Did somebody pop into your mind for this? Share with them, lift them up in being the love of God, that persevering love. Because let me tell you, when you're loving in those hard times, sometimes it feels very lonely. And some of what we're to do is to encourage each other. You know, a key element in understanding this type of risky love is that we are called to love those who are indeed hard to love. And Gayla touched on that with the children's message. We aren't given permission to cut anyone off. We don't draw lines and say we'll love this person, but not this person, right? And there is risk with loving. There's a risk of being hurt. There's a risk of being hurt. And our God took that risk for us. I want to make sure that I'm clear when I talk about loving those that can be hard to love. This does not mean that we are fodder for abuse. So don't hear me say, stay in an abusive relationship because you have to love, right? That's not what I'm saying, and I don't believe that that's what God has said. Sometimes we are called to love from a distance, right? Setting boundaries. Those boundaries cause some distance. But it doesn't mean that we stop praying for the person, that we keep encouraging the person. Hosea was called to a love like that. He was called to a love that would not necessarily be what you would expect in his relationship with Gomer. But Hosea was able to have conversation. Hosea was able to give and to tell the story in a way of God's hurt and anger in a way that was authentic because he had experienced something similar. Not exactly the same, but similar. Have you ever thought about a time when you have experienced something that is deeply hurtful, something that is deeply moving, something that deeply impacts your life, and then you are able to share that with someone else who may have a similar, because we all have our own stories, but there are those that have had similar experiences. And if we can testify in the midst of all of this to our very, 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 very faithful God, a God who does not forsake us, a God who does not turn his back on us, a God who constantly calls us back into relationship. We can testify in those hard times, sad times, heartbreaking times, that God is with us. That, my friends, is being a prophet. That is telling the story. That is giving God's message that God is always with us. God is always faithful, and God loves us infinitely. Now, that's not without consequence, right? Right? Gala spoke about the need to repent and the need to ask for forgiveness, to turn back to God when we have strayed, when we have wandered off, when we are behaving in a way that is less than loving. Be encouraged from this story today that our God loves us faithfully and forever. You've read the stories, you've heard the stories of the people of Israel who strayed and came back and strayed and came back, right? Can we relate to that? Have we strayed and come back and strayed and come back? Sometimes we do that daily, sometimes multiple times in a day. But God calls us into right relationship with God. Will you pray with me? God, sometimes we don't understand why you give us the commands to do what you have given us. Sometimes we don't understand when we hear your words. God, help us to be faithful when we hear you tell us what to do, even when it doesn't make sense. God, help us to love those that are hard to love. Heal our hearts when they are hurt. Give us the courage to lean into your love as the source of strength so that we may love those who are difficult to love. God, we thank you for sending Jesus to redeem us and restore us and atone for our sins. We are humbled by that amazing gift of love. We thank you and we love you with all that we are. Amen. You are invited to stand and sing, "Bind Us Together." And the words are on the screen. Really think about what it means to be bound together in Christian love. The fabric of our faith community, the fabric of our society, being bound together in love.
Bind us together, Lord, bind us together.
affirm our faith through the World Methodist Social Affirmation. It is a call and response. We believe in God, creator of the world and of all people, and in Jesus Christ, incarnate among us, who died and rose again, and in the Holy Spirit, present with us to guide, strengthen, and comfort.
We believe in God and all
we rejoice in every sign of God's kingdom, in the upholding of human dignity and community, in every expression of love, justice, and reconciliation, in each act of self-giving on behalf of others, in the abundance of God's gifts entrusted to us that all may have enough, in all responsible use of the earth's resources.
Glory to Jesus, God on high, and on earth peace.
We confess our sin, individual and collective, by silence or action, through the violation of human dignity based on race, class, age, sex, nation, or faith, through the exploitation of people because of greed and indifference, through the misuse of power in personal, communal, national, and international life, through the search for security by those military and economic forces that threaten human existence, through the abuse of technology which endangers the earth and all life upon it.
Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
We commit ourselves individually and as a community to the way of Christ, to take up the cross, to seek abundant life for all humanity, to struggle for peace with justice and freedom, to risk ourselves in faith, hope, and love, praying that God's kingdom may come.
Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. Amen.
You may be seated. Having received the grace of God in the redemption of Christ, we live strengthened in the faith, with hearts overflowing with thankfulness. From the depths of our heart, let us offer to God the very best we have. May our offering be a true act of worship and thanksgiving. You're invited to place your offering in the box at the back of the church. And those worshiping with us from home, your offering may be mailed in or given electronically through our website. Let us gather our gifts together and open them in gratitude and praise to the one who gave his whole self for redemption. To this day, knowing that your love is not dependent on our best moments, but on how we have persevered in finding the discipleship path after we have fallen short. May our gifts and our lives themselves be a witness to your relentless love. We pray in the holy name of Christ, our Redeemer. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Thank you. We now move into a time of prayer. And as we do that, one of the things that I'm going to ask Caitlin to advance the slides to the next slide. We have some paper copies. We've got more coming this week. But in the directory, which has a list of our members and attenders, and we have some new families that have been attending with us for the last few weeks or so, maybe the last month, we need to add them in here at some point. So we will do that. We'll give you an addendum to add. But we have within the directory a prayer challenge. And I'm going to invite you to, when you get your directory, to each day open it. So put it someplace where you're going to find it. And I'd like you to start at the beginning. And on day one, pray for this first family listed. And then the next day, pray for the next family. And the next day, the next family. And work your way each day all the way through the families listed in our directory. And then when you're done, start over again. The power of praying for each other cannot be overstated. It is so important for us to pray for each other and to do that in an intentional, deliberate way. And the directory is a great tool to remind us to do that. You can even jot the date down next to them when you've prayed for them. And I'll share a story with you as to how this challenge came about. You see, when I was a student pastor at Trinity, that is a church that my children and I, we moved our membership from our church in Texas to that church. That was the first church that our membership was with when we moved back to Maryland. It was a large church. I could be anonymous. It was wonderful because it was a time where I needed healing, right? And when you're in a small church, everybody knows your name and everybody knows your business, and there wasn't a lot of space for healing. So this large church provided that. And interestingly, so that was in 2006, about probably 2004, 2005. So fast forward to 2018, when I'm now serving in that church as a student pastor. And one of the ladies came up to me. I had been there for several months. And she said, I pulled out one of my old directories and I happened to notice you and your kids were members here. I said, yeah, a long time ago we were. And she said, I prayed for you. And she had her directory and she showed me the dates that she had prayed for my family. I don't know about you guys, but that was incredibly humbling. It was incredibly powerful. I would have never have thought of it on my own. This is the beauty of the community of faith. So I now issue to you, this congregation, the challenge to pray for each other every day using your directory as that tool. So that's one of our first intercessory prayers, is that we lift all of our church family in prayer each day. So we have some joys and we have some concerns that we want to lift, and I am going to take a moment of a personal privilege and ask Caitlin to flip the switch again. I have a wonderful joy to share. My nephew and Jacob and his wife Nikki had a beautiful baby girl on Wednesday, Alita Renee Aloishandera Hostetler. She was just under 7 pounds and is adorable. My sister's been FaceTiming with me and she's already smiling and scrunching her nose and making all those little baby sounds that newborns make. So that's a great joy in our family. What are our other joys that we lift today in prayer?
For Cody.
For Cody on the drums. Yes. Cody, you are a joy and a blessing to this church family.
And our bell ringers.
And the bell ringers, yes. I don't know any of you that are on Facebook. I had to Monday, I couldn't stand it. Musical Monday here. The bells were ringing. The Betsy and Aaron were practicing the traditional stuff. The praise band was here. It was wonderful. Wonderful. It's a joy, making a joyful noise.
Thank God for the rain.
And for the rain, yes. We give God great praise and thanksgiving for the rain. Other joys. Jenny?
My friend Rodney Lees, which I asked for prayer last week because he was having a PET scan this week. And so he went from stage 4 lung cancer to being cancer free. And his doctor said, I can't really explain this. And Rodney said, I can. It's very simple. God healed me. So, I mean, he had had surgery too and was on a small dose of chemo, but he was told to get his affairs in order. And so this week that all turned around.
And praise God for that healing. Praise God. The power of prayer can never be understated or overstated. Amen. Seeing all the littles in church. And the Good Shepherd Preschool, we've got a whole bunch of new littles that have started this month, and we've got another batch starting next month. And we've kind of cycled, right? So we had a bunch of the ones that were little when I first got here, and they've now graduated to kindergarten. So now we got another bunch of littles. They're so cute. And they're sponges. They're just soaking in God's love and the Word of God. It's amazing. What are some of our concerns today that we lift to God?
Lester, my friend Lester.
Lester. I also want to lift Addie Creek. I spoke with Joyce this morning, and Addie was in a car accident. She was hit, but she's okay. The car is not, but she is okay. Joyce and Lee are with her now. We'll probably be down in with her this week. But we lift Addie, and we lift Jack Webb. Jack has been significantly under the weather with COVID. We lift the family of Anna Pennington. Anna was a recipient of Camp Joy this year. One of the groups built a beautiful 42-foot ramp for her. And Anna passed on to eternal life on Saturday morning. And her daughters have been with her. I've been with the family quite a bit this week as she was nearing that time of transition. We will be having her funeral here in the church this coming week. I don't have a date yet, but with Joyce being with Addie, Carolyn and Suzanne have stepped up to help to coordinate the funeral meal. So if anybody is, if you're able to and would like to help, please see Carolyn or Suzanne about helping with the meal this week. I'm thinking it's going to be either Wednesday or Saturday, but I don't have a date yet. So. Other families.
My sister-in-law, Jenny, got her ankle broken this week, breaking up by the school. So we need to pray for her and pray for the other people that are
at her home. Yeah. When Linda shared this with me earlier, my heart aches for the teachers and the administrators who are in schools where the kids' emotions are running so high that their outlet is violence. So we need to lift our teachers and administrators, specifically Jenny, for a hedge of protection and for God's peace and calm to invade the spaces where they are teaching. We need to lift the children who are, that is their reaction. What is causing this to be the reaction, right? So how can we show love even when it's hard to love, right? So we lift the kids of Hancock High School. Carl.
Pray for John and Shannon Elmore. We lost their mother this week. John and Shannon grew up in this church. So
John and Shannon
Elmore.
What do you know their mom's name?
Shirley.
Shirley.
My birthday is 18.
Okay. We lift the family of Shirley Elmore as they grieve her loss.
I ask you to keep everyone keep kind of prayer. Marshall Hill, he's been battling cancer for a long time. He's hanging in there. I just, you know, concerned about him, and ask everybody to keep him in prayer if they would.
So we lift Marshall.
Chris and Cheryl Deal.
Chris and Cheryl Deal.
Ruth Bradley's sister's family, and the loss of her husband, her dearest husband, Blevins family.
The Blevins family, as they are also grieving. Donnie and Robin, and Anna and Dean, as they continue to grieve. We lift up Lillian and Ken. There's been a lot of loss in the recent weeks. How can we be God's love for those who are grieving? Let us go to God in prayer. Gracious God, we've lifted many joys. We lift the joy of this community of faith and all the new life, the rain that you have provided to sustain us. We lift to you the talents and gifts that are shared. God, we lift to you those who are in need of healing, be it in mind, body, or spirit. We especially lift to you those who are grieving. May your peace and comfort surround them. May your peace, a peace that surpasses understanding, invade our school systems, our school buildings, our young people. God, we pray for travel mercies for our youth who are traveling between here and Baltimore today. We pray together in the words that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So we have a few announcements today. One of the things that the youth has asked me to convey to you is a huge thank you for the mums. All of the mums have been sold, so they are very excited about that, and thank you for your support of them in that endeavor. We have a sign-up sheet in the Welcome Center for delivering the food backpacks. We do that once a month. It's the first week of each month that we take, I believe it's about 23 backpacks now that are taken to the elementary school so that the children have something to eat over the weekend. We have a vision and planning workshop coming up October 21st. Please, please mark your calendars, because this is the vision and planning for our community of faith. It's not my plan. It's us coming together and really digging into where we see God calling our church to be the church, to be God's love in our communities today. I had somebody ask me about the kind of the normal ebb and flow of activity here at the church. So I'm going to run through a few things real quick just as a reminder. On Sundays, we do have Sundays two different times for Sunday school. At 8:30, there is a men's class and there's a separate women's class, the Sunshine class, that meet at 8:30. And then after worship, we have three classes that meet. We have another adult class. We have a teen class and a children's class that meet for Sunday school. On the second Sunday of each month, the young adults gather at Martha's house. And then our youth typically meet on the first and third Sunday of each month. And then on the fifth Sunday, we have a potluck following church. So Sundays are pretty busy days here in the life of our faith community. On the 29th, our next fifth Sunday potluck is the 29th of October, and it's hard to believe that that is just, like, next Sunday is October 1st. How did that happen? It seemed like it was just February. But on the 29th of October, bring a pumpkin. We're gonna carve pumpkins together. It'll be an activity. There will also be a dessert auction, and that auction is to raise funds for a new carillon, because our old carillon, that's analog, has finally, it's done. So we've got a new one that we've picked out, so we want to raise some funds for that so that we can get the bells chiming again in town. So that's the 29th of October, so put that on your calendar. If you are able to, this would be if you're a baker, a candy maker, anything like that, there will be a sign-up sheet next week in the Welcome Center to let us know what you're going to put in the auction. So Mondays, let's jump back to the life of our life and the ebb and flow of our life here together. On Mondays, we gather down by the boat ramp for meditation at 8:00. On Mondays, Meals on Wheels is delivered. There's a group that does that ministry. Monday evening, Music Mondays here in the evenings. The traditional music rehearses at 5:30, handbell at 6, and praise band at 7. So that's Mondays. Mondays can be pretty busy too. Tuesdays, 10:00, we have chair yoga and meditation. This week we had two new visitors that came and participated, and they both said, well, if I knew it was gonna be like this, I'd have come earlier. So if you're not sure what it is, come check it out. We also have Disciple Bible Study on Tuesday nights. This is Disciple 3, and we're studying the prophets. On the second Tuesday of every month, the leadership team meets at 7:00 in the upper room. And then on Wednesdays, on the third Wednesday of the month, the flower bed care team gathers and takes care of the flower bed down on Maine and Pennsylvania. Thursdays are another busy day in the life of our church. We have Disciple Bible Study at 6:00, and this is a Disciple 1 class that's done virtually via Zoom. The first Thursday of every month is the Micah's backpack delivery. And then the third Thursday of the month, we have table worship at noon. And then following that, So Many Prayers Ministry is gathering and working on the prayer squares, the quote squares. So that's what is kind of always on the schedule for what's going on in the life of our church. And then there are other things that you'll see in the bulletin, like we had a cleanup day on Saturday. We're gonna have our church conferences coming up. So there's a lot going on. I encourage you to please read the bulletin and read the announcements and plug in. There's lots of opportunity to fellowship and serve and worship together. So with that, I'm going to invite you to stand as we sing our closing song, Loving God and Loving Each Other. Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.